Remember that training exercise where like everything that could go wrong just completely fell apart?
Oh, yeah.
Comms were down, intel was fuzzy, and that ravine we thought was impassable.
Right.
Yeah, well, turned out not so much. We had to improvise, think on our feet, toss the playbook out the window, you know, adapt or die kind of thing.
What's wild is that's exactly what ADP 5.0 is all about, that adaptability in the face of
It's
chaos.
not just some dusty manual, though, is it?
No.
It's the Army's way of saying, hey, the battlefield's a changing place. Your planning better keep up. Which is why we're diving deep into ADP 5.0 today. We've got excerpts from the document, some nuggets of wisdom from military masterminds, and even a peek into how planning, or lack thereof, shaped history.
You're right. The battlefield has changed, hasn't it? Cyber warfare, space, the information environment, it's all connected.
Yeah, we're not just talking about tanks and trenches anymore.
Not anymore, no.
So how does ADP 5.0 help us make sense of this new world? What's the mission of this deep dive?
To put it simply, we're going to equip you with the core principles of planning outlined in ADP 5.0 so that you can be more effective, more adaptable, and frankly, a better soldier, ready for whatever this modern battlefield throws your way.
I like it. And that actually reminds me of this quote we pulled from Sir Basil Liddell Hart. He said, "To be practical, any plan must take account of the enemy's power to frustrate it. The best chance of overcoming such obstruction is to have a plan that can be easily varied to fit the circumstances met. To keep such adaptability while still keeping the initiative, the best way is to operate along a line which offers alternative objectives."
Wow.
Which sounds a lot like that training exercise we were just talking about.
It really does, and that's what ADP 5.0 emphasizes, that the enemy, well, they have a vote, and deviations from the plan, they're going to happen. Your plan, it can't just be a rigid set of instructions. It needs to be a flexible framework for making decisions when the unexpected happens.
And you know it's going to happen.
It will happen.
So less following a script, more like jazz improv.
Exactly. Planning, as ADP 5.0 defines it, it's both an art and a science.
So, okay, so not just paperwork then.
Definitely not just paperwork. It's about understanding your situation, picturing where you need to be, and figuring out how to bridge that gap effectively. It's about anticipating the challenges, organizing your resources, directing your team, all while being ready to adapt on the fly.
And that adapting on the fly part, that's where the art comes in.
Precisely. The science side of planning, that involves, the quantifiable factors, logistics, your terrain analysis, clear communication tools, those bread and butter things.
Right, gotta have those comms,
It's
especially when things get a little dicey.
You do. But even with the most perfect intel, meticulous calculations, there's always that element of uncertainty. And that's where the art of planning comes in. Judgment calls, instinct, factoring in things you can't necessarily quantify on a spreadsheet.
Like enemy movements, civilian reactions, fog of war.
All of that's where the art of planning meets the science, blending together to create a plan that can actually weather those unpredictable elements.
So speaking of blending art and science, that kind of reminds me of a quote from Antoine-Henri Jomini. He said, "Logistics comprises the means and arrangements which work out the plans of strategy and tactics. Strategy decides where to act. Logistics brings the troops to this point."
I like that.
Yeah, it's a pretty clear-cut example of those two elements working hand in hand.
It really is. Even the most brilliant strategy is meaningless if you can't get your troops and your supplies where they need to be.
Right, like planning an amazing road trip but forgetting to, fill up the tank.
Right.
So we've talked about what planning is, this blend of art and science, but why should soldiers care? What's the benefit of wrapping your head around all of this?
It's all about giving you, the soldier, a framework for action. ADP 5.0 boils it down to four key functions: understanding, organizing, directing, and adapting. And these aren't just like abstract ideas. They're directly applicable to what you do every day, from, squad level operations all the way up to a full-blown theater campaign.
Okay, so let's break that down a bit, starting with understanding. Now we're back to that chaotic training exercise. Comms are fried, intel's fuzzy. How does ADP 5.0 help us make sense of that situation?
It all starts by going beyond just knowing your objective. You need to analyze everything: terrain, enemy capabilities, but also the political landscape, what the locals are thinking, even what's happening in cyberspace.
So, like connecting the dots, seeing the bigger picture, even when the situation on the ground feels like a million little pieces.
Exactly. You've got to analyze those pieces, but then put them all together to paint a clear picture of the environment you're operating in. What happens in cyberspace can have a real impact on a ground operation, and vice versa.
It's all connected. Wild. So once we've, wrapped our heads around the situation, we move on to getting organized. If we're that squad in the field, how does this apply? We're not exactly planning D-Day here.
Even at the squad level, ADP 50's emphasis on task organizing and prioritizing, it's critical. It's about forming teams, making sure everyone knows their role, and ensuring they have what they need when they need it. You wouldn't, send a soldier on patrol without his weapon or a medic without their aid bag, right? That's task organizing in action.
Right, right. Okay, so it's about like making sure everyone has the right tools for the job. But it sounds like there's more to it than just handing out gear.
Oh, right? Absolutely. It also highlights the importance of those command and support relationships.
Yeah.
Knowing who you report to, who has your back, and what those relationships entail, that's critical for mission success at every level.
So if things go sideways, you know who to call for backup, literally and figuratively.
Exactly. A reliable and prepared support network can be a real game changer in a high-pressure situation.
Right. Makes sense. So we've analyzed the situation, we're organized, and the next step is making it happen. This is where direct, coordinate, synchronize all come into play. Yeah.
You got it. Clear communication is absolutely key here. We're talking about issuing clear orders, making sure everyone understands their roles, but also empowering your people to make decisions on the ground. You can't be micromanaging when the bullets start flying.
No time for backseat driving in a firefight.
Exactly. Trust and clear intent are paramount. And that's where control measures come in.
Control measures. So back to our training exercise scenario.
Yeah.
What would that look like for our squad?
Think of control measures as tools to guide the operation without stifling your team's ability to adapt. They can be permissive, allowing some freedom of action, or restrictive, setting clear limits.
Okay, got any examples of that?
Sure. A coordinated fire line, that's a great example of a permissive control measure. It establishes boundaries for engagement without the need for constant communication, allowing for more flexibility and quick reaction to threats.
So more freedom of action within those boundaries.
Exactly. On the other hand, a designated route for a patrol that's more restrictive, it limits flexibility but might be necessary for safety or to coordinate with other units. It's about finding that balance between control and adaptability.
Right, right. Makes sense. So we've got understanding, organizing, directing, and now we come to adapting, which if we're thinking back to that training exercise, feels like where things really went off the rails.
And that's exactly what ADP 50 wants you to be prepared for. This is where those branches and sequels we talked about earlier, they become so crucial. It's about constantly thinking ahead, anticipating those what-ifs, and having a plan ready to go when things inevitably deviate from the original plan. Remember, no plan survives contact with the enemy perfectly intact.
So it's like having a plan B, C, and D already in your back pocket, just in case.
Exactly. Even more than that, it's about cultivating a mindset of adaptation, being able to think on your feet and adjust to the changing reality on the ground. President Eisenhower, a man who knew a thing or two about planning complex operations, put it perfectly when he said, "Plans are worthless, but planning is everything."
It's about the process, the mindset it ingrains in you, rather than just the plan itself.
Exactly. It's about developing that mental agility, being able to adjust and overcome whatever the situation throws at you. Now, to better understand how these four functions play out in the real world, let's shift gears a bit and look at how planning works at different levels, from, your squad all the way up to the Pentagon.
Okay, so we're moving from the what of planning to the how and where it fits into the bigger picture.
Exactly. ADP 50 breaks it down into three main levels of planning: tactical, operational, and strategic. And while your day-to-day experience might be focused on that tactical level, understanding how it connects to those higher levels, it can give you valuable context.
Right, because even though we're focused on our specific mission, we're still part of something much larger.
Absolutely. Let's start with the tactical level, since that's likely where most of our listeners operate.
Right, back to our squad in the field.
Exactly. Tactical planning is where the rubber meets the road, so to speak. It's about making decisions under pressure, often with limited time and resources. This is where those acronyms you might have heard of come into play. Things like the military decision-making process, or MDMP, and troop leading procedures, or TLPs.
So for those of us who aren't fluent in Army acronyms, what exactly are MDMP and TLPs?
Think of them as your go-to tools for planning and executing missions at your level. MDMP is a detailed, step-by-step process for planning operations, while TLPs provide a more flexible framework for leaders to prepare their units for any mission. They're all about taking those big picture objectives and breaking them down into actionable tasks at the squad and platoon level.
So kind of like taking that blueprint for a building and focusing in on the details of actually constructing a specific room.
Precisely. And those tools, just like all the principles in ADP 5.0, they're designed to help you adapt to the ever-changing conditions of the battlefield.
Okay, so that's the tactical level.
Yeah.
But their OSS squad is still part of a larger company, battalion, and so on. That's where the operational and strategic levels come in, right?
Exactly. The operational level, it bridges the gap between those big picture strategic goals and what you're doing on the ground. It's about designing campaigns, planning major operations, making sure everything is synchronized. Think of it like this. If the strategic level is deciding to build a house, the operational level is creating the blueprints and figuring out the logistics.
So if tactical is about building that one room, operational is making sure all the rooms fit together to make a functional house.
Precisely. And then at the very top, you have the strategic level. This is where those national objectives are set, where we determine how we're going to use military force to achieve our national interests. It's the why behind everything we do.
So back to our house analogy. The strategic level is deciding why we need to build this house in the first place.
Exactly. It's about setting those overarching goals that guide everything else.
Okay, so we've got these three levels all working together, like gears in a machine. But even with the best laid plans, things rarely go perfectly right.
That's where the art of planning really shines, and that's where we dive into a concept called operational art.
Operational art. Sounds a bit more highbrow than just planning.
It might sound complicated, but it's really about thinking like a commander, seeing the battlefield from a broader perspective.
So less about kicking down doors, more about strategically outmaneuvering your opponent.
You got it. Operational art is about understanding not just what you're doing, but why you're doing it. It's about looking beyond the immediate objective and considering the broader implications of your actions.
Sounds like we're getting into some big picture thinking here.
Mm-hmm.
But how does that translate down to the tactical level? If our squad's in the middle of that chaotic exercise, how does operational art factor in?
It's about understanding your role within the larger context of the mission. Your squad might be tasked with taking that hill, but why is that hill so important? What are we trying to achieve by taking it? That's where operational art comes in.
Okay, so it's about knowing the why behind the what.
Precisely. And that understanding, it can make you a more effective soldier, even at the tactical level. It allows you to make better decisions on the fly, to anticipate the enemy's moves, and to adapt to changing circumstances.
So even if we're just one small piece of the puzzle, understanding the bigger picture helps us make smarter decisions in the moment.
Exactly. And it's something that ADP 5.0 emphasizes throughout. Planning isn't just about following orders. It's about thinking critically, understanding the context of your mission, and being ready to adapt when those inevitable curveballs come your way.
It sounds like we need to dive a little deeper into this whole operational art thing. What exactly does it entail? All right, so operational art, it's about thinking like a commander, seeing that chessboard from a wider perspective. But what are the actual moves in this game? How does ADP 5.0 break it down?
It all starts with understanding three key elements: your end state, centers of gravity, and decisive points.
Okay, let's start with that end state. What does victory look like in this context?
So the end state is that ultimate goal you're trying to achieve. And it's not just about winning a battle or taking an objective. It's about what that situation needs to look like when the dust settles, setting the stage for, you know, long-term success.
So it's not just about defeating the enemy. It's about creating like a more stable, secure situation overall.
You got it. And that end state, it needs to be clearly defined from the get-go because it's going to guide all of your decisions along the way.
Okay, so we've got our sights set on that end state. Now, what about those centers of gravity?
Centers of gravity, those are the crucial factors that give your adversary the ability to fight, to resist, to achieve their objectives.
So if we're back in that training exercise, what would be the opposing force's center of gravity?
Their communication hub, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Or a key leader. Could even be a particularly advantageous piece of terrain. Identifying and understanding their center of gravity, it's essential because it reveals their vulnerabilities.
Which brings us to decisive points.
Exactly. Decisive points are those specific points of vulnerability that, if exploited effectively, can cripple the enemy's center of gravity and pave the way to achieving your end state.
So if their comms hub is the center of gravity, the decisive point might be that barely defended antenna array we spotted.
Bingo. Operational art is about recognizing those connections, those key points of leverage that can swing the balance in your favor. It's about being strategic in your thinking, even at the tactical level.
Well, the game of chess, right?
Right.
Figuring out which pieces to move to put the opponent in checkmate.
Exactly. And just like in chess, tempo is crucial. ADP 5-0, it emphasizes that tempo isn't just about speed. It's about finding the right rhythm for the operation.
So sometimes a slow, deliberate advance, it's more effective than just a full-on assault.
You got it. It's about matching your actions to the situation, dictating the pace of the fight. And of course, no discussion of military operations is complete without talking about risk.
Right, because let's face it, even with the best plans, things can get a little unpredictable out there.
Absolutely. ADP 5-0, it acknowledges that risk is inherent in everything we do. You can't eliminate it entirely, but you can mitigate it through careful planning, clear communication, and that ever-important adaptability we keep coming back to. Remember, boldness is important, but recklessness, well, that'll get you in trouble.
That reminds me of a quote we've got from Field Marshal Rommel. He said, "A bold operation is one in which success is not a certainty, but which in case of failure leaves one with sufficient forces in hand to cope with whatever situation may arise."
That's a great quote. It really gets at that balance we're talking about. It's about calculated risks, not just, you know, blind faith. Now, we've covered a lot of ground here, but ADP 5-0 isn't just about these high-level concepts. It also provides really practical advice on how to actually plan effectively, no matter your level of responsibility.
Okay, so, like, what are some of the key takeaways? If our listeners are going to walk away from this deep dive and actually apply what they've learned, what should they focus on?
First and foremost, simplicity and clarity are key. Remember General Patton's words? It is my opinion that Army orders should not exceed a page and a half of typewritten text.
So no need for overly complicated jargon or like 100-page PowerPoint presentations.
Exactly. A clear, concise plan, it's easier to understand, easier to communicate, and way easier to adapt when things change.
Makes sense. And speaking of adapting, ADP 5-0, it really stresses the importance of those tenets of unified land operations that we talked about earlier.
It does. Simultaneity, depth, synchronization, and flexibility. Those principles, they're crucial for creating a plan that can handle those inevitable curveballs that the battlefield's going to throw at you.
Right, right. And what about those pitfalls we talked about earlier? Any common mistakes that that we should be aware of when it comes to planning?
One of the biggest traps is trying to be overly prescriptive in your planning, especially when you're dealing with complex and uncertain situations.
So don't get bogged down trying to predict every single detail.
Exactly. You want to provide clear guidance, but also empower your subordinates to make decisions on the ground. Remember, no plan survives contact with the enemy perfectly intact, so adaptability is key.
Right. It's about finding that sweet spot between detailed planning and leaving room for, you know, adjustment when you need it.
Exactly. And another common mistake is forgetting about the human element. Planning, it isn't just about maps and objectives, it's about people.
Right. Factoring in things like morale, training, and even just the, you know, the fog of war, that stuff that can't be predicted on a spreadsheet.
You got it. The best plans, they take into account the human factors at play, both for your own troops and for any civilians operating in the area.
Right, right. So we've covered a lot of ground here, from the core principles of planning to, you know, those practical tips for success. Any final thoughts before we wrap up?
Just this. Planning, it's an ongoing process. It's not a one-time event. The best planners are the ones who constantly seek out new information, who are willing to adapt their plans as needed, and who never stop learning. ADP 5-0, it's a great resource, but it's just the starting point. Take the principles you've learned today and put them into practice.
And remember, think back to your own experiences, those moments where adaptability was key. How can you apply the principles of ADP 5-0 to be a more effective, adaptable, and ultimately successful soldier? That's the challenge we'll leave you with today. Thanks for joining us for this deep dive into ADP 5-0.